Nuclear power promised the Soviet Union a supply of cheap and limitless energy, and Chernobyl was the newest of its plans, a triumph of Soviet science. But in just 1 hour and 24 minutes, a routine safety test spirals out of control. Thirty-one people die, hundreds are poisoned, and a toxic cloud spreads as far as Asia and the United States. Now we return to Chernobyl with the men who were involved, and cutting-edge computer technology will reveal exactly what went wrong. Disasters don't just happen. They're triggered by a chain of critical events. Unravel the fateful decisions in those final seconds from disaster. The Soviet Union, Ukraine, Chernobyl. April 25th, 1986. Soviet Premier Mikhail Gorbachev has been in power for 1 year. Communism and Western democracy are still pitted against each other. The Soviet Union needs a cheap source of energy, and the answer is nuclear power. Over 2 million people in Kiev, Ukraine's major city, get their electricity from the state-run power plant, Chernobyl. Located 65 miles away, Chernobyl is a symbol of the Soviet Union's industrial and technological muscle. Soviet nuclear scientists consider it to be the best of the nation's nuclear plants. Boris Stolarchuk controls the water pumps that cool the reactor. Tonight, his every move will mean the difference between life and death.
I was young then and just loved the job. I was proud of being able to manage such unique equipment, to take part in the operation of such powerful machines.
Also on this fateful night, 29-year-old Yuri Karnaev will control the massive turbines that generate electricity. Chernobyl has 4 reactors, all running at the same time. Reactor number 4 is the newest, only 3 years old. The reactors work like giant steam engines. Their uranium fuel rods heat water. The steam they produce drives turbines. And that's how they generate power. When everything works right, the benefits are enormous. Just 2 pounds of uranium produces the same amount of energy as more than 3,300 tons of coal. But using uranium to produce energy is a balancing act that requires top-tier engineering. On this night, Boris and Yuri work the late shift, starting at midnight. They're relatively young, but are fully qualified to be working in such a complex environment. They arrive half an hour early.
This is so the staff can examine the switches and readings left by the previous shift, as well as the general condition of the plant.
But tonight will be different. As the midnight shift gathers, they're in for a surprise. Their supervisors order them to perform a safety drill. It's crucial for a nuclear power plant to pump cooling water around the reactor. At Chernobyl, the electricity to run the water pumps comes from its turbines, which in turn are powered by the reactor. It's a perpetual cycle of energy production. But if something goes wrong, it could lead to a nuclear disaster. Tonight's drill is to find out if the plant can keep running until backup generators kick in during an emergency. Earlier attempts to run this test have been inconclusive.
It meant some extra work, but it wasn't complex.
The water that cools the reactors comes from a canal running alongside the plant. It's a magnet for local fishermen. Tonight, Pyotr Tolstikov is fishing with a friend.
We thought we could fish for a little while. The weather was wonderful, and we caught some.
от водохранилища по подводному каналу.
Толстяков has a ringside seat at reactor number 4. Midnight. The night shift begins. Yuri Korneyev heads to the turbine hall.
I examined the turbine and studied the readings. We had a cup of tea and were waiting for an order to start the test.
Boris Stolarchuk is in the control room, about 1,000 feet from the reactor. He's joined by 27-year-old Leonid Toptanov, who controls the reactor. They are about to begin a very complex balancing act. And Chernobyl's fire departments are on standby in case of an emergency. 12:05 a.m. Preparations for the test begin. Leonid gradually reduces power. For the next 20 minutes, everything goes as planned. But just 3 minutes later, there's a snag. For some reason, power levels in the reactor plummet. This isn't part of the drill. And Leonid needs to get the power level back up again. To his relief, he fixes the problem. By 1 o'clock in the morning, Leonid thinks the reactor is stable. So the preparations proceed. 3 minutes later, Boris, who controls the pumps, takes his turn. He switches on two auxiliary water pumps. But they force water into the reactor too quickly. This means that not enough water can be turned into steam to drive the turbines. They're out of balance. Leonid thinks he can help by increasing power in the reactor's core. It works. The reactor gets hotter, creating more steam to drive the turbines. Leonid and Boris think they have the situation under control. So again, they continue with the test preparations. What they don't know is that the core is heating up to dangerous levels. In the turbine hall, Yuri Korneyev gets a phone call. Someone in the control room tells him the preparations are complete and the test is about to start. To the crew on the night shift, everything at Chernobyl appears to be normal. 1:23. An operator shuts down the turbines as planned. This is the start of the test they've been preparing for since the beginning of the shift. But just as Leonid monitors the reactor, he sees its temperature begin to soar. Pressure in the reactor is critical. Warning alarms blare through the control room. Leonid and Boris know they have a serious problem. But they don't know that they're only moments away from a full-blown nuclear catastrophe. Engineers at Chernobyl, the Soviet Union's most modern nuclear plant, are running a safety drill. But there are problems, and it's evident that something is wrong. The young men struggle to prevent a major nuclear accident. It's 1:23 a.m. Leonid Toptanov is in charge of the reactor. He takes drastic measures and hits the reactor's emergency shutdown button. But there's no shutdown. And worse, the heat of the reactor races higher, reaching 100 times normal levels. The unimaginable begins. Extreme heat starts to destroy the core. Boris and Leonid realize they are no longer in control. Just 1 minute later, Chernobyl's number 4 reactor explodes. The force of the explosion blows the reactor's 2,000-ton steel roof sideways. 8 tons of highly radioactive fuel blasts into the night sky. In the turbine hall, Yuri Karnaev watches in disbelief. The roof crashes down around him.
I couldn't say a word. I crouched near the control panel. When the roof stopped falling, I thought, well, thank God, it hasn't fallen on me.
In the control room, almost 1,000 feet away, engineer Boris Stolarchuk's nightmare begins.
I felt something strange was going on. I heard a big bang. I was petrified. I didn't know what to do.
Outside Chernobyl, fisherman Pyotr Tolstikov becomes an eyewitness to history.
Explosion is an imprecise word. It was like a volcanic eruption.
The alarm goes off at the plant's fire station. Within 4 minutes of the explosion, 14 firefighters race to the scene. Fire has broken out all over Reactor 4. Fire Chief Pyotr Hamel is one of 100 extra firefighters who responds to the call.
There were bits of wires lying around. All the technical units were in pieces. We didn't know it was the reactor because no one had told us.
The firemen are in the midst of a nuclear catastrophe. For an hour and a half, they struggle with the flames. And one by one, the men start to collapse, vomiting and losing consciousness. Pyotr Hamel is among them.
We didn't think it was a dangerous event. Not on a global scale. We thought it was just a normal fire.
By 5 in the morning, the flames are extinguished. Pyotr is flown to a Moscow hospital for emergency treatment. He is suffering from the effects of radiation. But at least he survives. Of the 69 firefighters at the blaze, 31 die from direct exposure to radiation. But this is only the start of the crisis. The shattered reactor continues to emit lethal radiation. But Soviet authorities react with silence. In the race between the West and the Soviet Union, Premier Gorbachev tries to hide the disaster. Most of the power plant's employees live with their families in the town of Pripyat, almost 2 miles away. They have no idea that their lives are at risk. Oksana Savchenko was 13 years old at the time. Her father was working in reactor number 4 and didn't return home in the morning.
Соседка к маме заходила, говорила, сказала, что
a neighbor visited my mom and told her that something had happened at the plant and that no one had come back yet. Her husband was working there. We felt tense. We suspected that something was wrong.
By evening, there is still no news of Oksana's father. The Soviet authorities begin top secret preparations to evacuate the entire population of Pripyat. Almost 50,000 people. For the evacuation to be swift and efficient, the army is called in to organize a 1,200 bus convoy. 36 hours after the explosion, the residents of Pripyat get their first official information.
Attention, comrades. An unsatisfactory radioactive situation has occurred at the Chernobyl power station. As a temporary precaution, it has been decided to evacuate the citizens of Pripyat.
Оксана is stunned.
Собрать необходимые вещи, взять продукты в дорогу.
They told us we should pack and prepare some food for the trip.
Ну, деньги и...
We should take our documents and money, of course, and wait for the buses to arrive.
Просто ждать, когда начнут подавать автобусы.
Оксана's father is still missing, but her family has no choice. They must leave. No one knows where they'll be taken. The mass evacuation begins at 2 p.m. 3 hours later, Pripyat is a ghost town. The column of buses and trucks stretches for more than 9 miles. At Chernobyl, the reactor continues to spew out deadly radiation. Authorities scramble to halt further radioactive fallout. And over the next 6 days, 1,800 helicopter runs drop 5,000 tons of chemicals into the destroyed reactor to absorb the radiation. But a much more dangerous plan is lurking. So far, the Soviets assume that only those directly affected know about the crisis. But it's the Cold War, and U.S. satellites carry out constant surveillance over the Soviet Union. Just 28 seconds after the explosion, a satellite passes over Chernobyl. This is the image it captures. At first, U.S. intelligence thinks that the Soviets have launched a nuclear missile, but the red shows an area of intense heat at the Chernobyl nuclear power plant. Something has gone horribly wrong. 6:30 a.m. on April 28th. 2 days after the disaster, nuclear engineer Cliff Robinson is driving to work to the Forsmark nuclear power plant in Sweden, almost 1,000 miles north of Chernobyl. To enter the site, Cliff has to pass through a radiation monitor.
The alarm went off, indicating that I was contaminated, and it was so strange because I hadn't been into the controlled area of the power station.
Cliff is puzzled. He re-enters the radiation monitor and sets off the alarm again and again. He assumes the equipment is faulty until other workers are also prevented from entering.
Nobody could go through this monitor because the alarm went off all the time.
Radiation is invisible. Cliff guesses it's the workers' shoes that keep triggering the alarm.
And I put it on one of our detectors and started a measurement. And the activity level was just enormous.
Cliff figures out that the radiation could not be from his plant at Forsmark.
My personal thought was that somebody must have exploded a nuclear weapon somewhere.
The hunt is on to find the source of the contamination. And later that same day, Swedish scientists identify where the radiation is coming from. the Soviet Union. They demand an explanation, and the Soviet Union bows to the pressure, publicly admitting to the Chernobyl accident. The disaster explodes into front-page news around the world. The press describes Chernobyl as an apocalypse.
An accident has occurred at the Chernobyl atomic power plant. One of the atomic reactors has been damaged.
Inside the USSR, the incident gets downplayed, buried under a host of other stories in the day's TV news.
Measures are being taken to eliminate the consequences. The victims are being given medical attention and an investigation committee has been set up.
Behind the news lies the larger truth. The Soviet nuclear dream is beginning to crumble. Signs of radioactive fallout emerge all over Europe. After 10 days, the toxic cloud has reached the United States and Asia. And there's a threat to other countries as well. It takes just 84 minutes to destroy Chernobyl's nuclear reactor. Now we rewind the events and focus on the engineers in the control room, who were ordered by their managers to perform a safety test. With cutting-edge computer simulation based on the official report, we'll go where no camera can, into the heart of Chernobyl's disaster zone. Immediately after the explosion, Soviet authorities bring in leading Russian scientists. For them, this is no ordinary forensic inquiry. To discover what went wrong, they must enter the melting reactor core, where the risk of radiation poisoning is the highest. The investigation begins with interviews. Alexander Agulov was just outside the reactor hall.
The door was torn off its hinges, lying in the opposite corner. We couldn't see anything in the doorway. Looking over the debris, I saw that the walls and ceiling had been destroyed. Water was flowing down the broken walls. This water was glowing.
Experts in the West have long been suspicious about the safety of Soviet reactors. British physicist Jim Al-Khalili has studied the flaws in Chernobyl's design.
They have an instability, something built into their design, which means that they can get very, very hot very, very quickly.
Senior officials knew about this design fault. So how did the disaster happen? Investigators gather at the scene to painstakingly reconstruct the events of the tragedy. They focus their attention on the safety drill. The test was supposed to take place during the day, when more senior engineers are on duty. But it would have meant shutting down the reactor and causing major disruption to Kiev's electricity. So the safety test is postponed until nighttime, when electricity demand on the plant is at its lowest. But by then, all the senior scientists have gone home, and a more junior team is left in charge of reactor number 4. The responsibility of carrying out the test falls on them. Which leads investigators to ask, was this a case of operator error or a flaw in reactor design? How did a safety test turn into the world's worst nuclear disaster? Direct exposure to radiation kills 31 firefighters in the aftermath of the Chernobyl explosion. Now a team of Soviet scientists must examine the deadly site. Investigators know that a safety test was underway before the blast. So are the operators to blame, or were there flaws in the reactor? Here's how the reactor should have functioned. Uranium rods are used to produce heat in the reactor's core. Control rods are inserted to regulate the amount of energy given off by the uranium. As water passes over the nuclear core, it turns into steam. Just as in any conventional power plant, the steam drives turbines that generate electricity. Chernobyl runs on the electrical energy it produces. Safety tests ensure that the plant could operate even if something in the electronic loop fails. Would the plant still have enough electricity to control its uranium fuel rods if the turbine stopped? Could the water pumps provide enough coolant? Under normal circumstances, the reactor can be sped up or slowed down by raising or lowering control rods in the core. Water pumped over the core keeps it from overheating and also produces steam for electricity. But if the plant's turbines can't produce the electricity that runs the crucial water pumps, the reactor could quickly overheat. Investigators shift their attention to the actions of the men on the night shift. The safety of the reactor depends on a delicate balancing act between these two men. Together, they ensure that there's always enough steam to drive the turbines and that the reactor core does not overheat. Although they were junior, both were experienced. So what happened that terrible night? 1 hour and 19 minutes before the explosion, when Leonid begins to power down the reactor core, it all seems to go well. At first, the reactor's control rods regulate the amount of energy the uranium fuel produces.
Steam, and hence the power output in the reactor core, is regulated using control rods. When the control rods are lowered into the core, they lower the amount of energy produced, and so less steam is produced to drive the turbines. When the control rods are lifted, the energy in the core increases again.
Reactor number 4 had 211 control rods that should have prevented the explosion. Why didn't they work? To prepare for the test, Leonid uses control rods to gradually reduce power. But power levels drop too much, too soon. 52 minutes before the blast. In order to raise power levels, Leonid takes out control rods. Slowly but surely, the power output creeps back up. Boris continues preparations for the drill by altering the water flow around the reactor core. The idea is that main pumps, which normally supply water, will stop during the simulated power failure. As a backup, Boris ensures that there is an alternate water supply. He plans to use two auxiliary pumps that will divert extra water from other parts of the power station to reactor 4. But when Boris turns on the extra pumps, he allows too much water into the reactor core too fast.
The rate that water flows over the fuel rods is crucial, because the faster the water flows over the fuel rods, the less steam is made.
After 15 minutes of pumping extra water into the system, there's not enough steam to keep the turbine running. 5 minutes. The team has to get the reactor in balance. Boris must increase the flow of steam to the turbines. He takes action, pumping water into the steam drum, a central chamber where both water and steam levels can be kept in check. As the volume of water increases in the drum, the steam pressure rises back to normal. But Boris allows too much cold water into the steam drum. The result? Excess water enters the reactor core. Once again, too little steam is being produced. And they haven't even started the test. Investigators know that the men in the control room are in serious trouble. They have just 4 minutes left. The only thing Leonid can do to increase the steam going to the turbines is to reduce the number of control rods in the core. Operating guidelines set the minimum at 26 control rods. Leonid feels he has no choice but to go full throttle. He removes all but 6 rods. Amazingly, at this critical stage, the night shift continues with the test. With so few control rods, the only thing that can stop the reactor from overheating is the water around its core. The smallest drop in water level could prove critical. Suddenly, the communication between Leonid and Boris breaks down. Less than 3 minutes before the explosion, Boris realizes that too much water has flowed into the steam drum, so he cuts the flow immediately. But it also affects the water flowing into the overheated reactor core. Boris makes no allowance for the fact that Leonid has removed all but 6 of the control rods.
I didn't know anything about it. And I can't say whether there were fewer rods than required.
1.5 minutes before the explosion, without enough control rods to keep the temperature in check, the reactor core is seriously overheating. But the night shift is still unaware that they've lost control of the power plant. Under extreme temperatures, Chernobyl's reactor number 4 is about to crumble.
The worst case scenario in any nuclear power station is that there's a buildup of heat and energy that becomes critical.
Still, investigators don't understand how the overheated core triggered the final explosion. 56 seconds before the blast, the turbine operator gets the order to proceed with a safety test. He shuts down the turbines. Suddenly, the dials show that the energy levels in the reactor are soaring dangerously high. Now, there's no time left. Disaster. A safety test at Chernobyl has turned into a catastrophe. The nuclear reactor is going to blow in just 13 seconds. And the men in the control room are helpless. Extreme heat ruptures the fuel rods. The blast generates a huge force of pressure against the reactor's 2,000-ton lid. 8 tons of highly radioactive debris explodes into the sky. Nothing like this has ever happened before. Radioactive fuel fragments explode directly into the atmosphere. Investigators calculate that they shoot more than 0.5 miles into the sky. Some of the radioactive material is light enough to be carried by the wind and spreads over thousands of miles. Within 10 days, it reaches as far as Japan and North America.
Radioactive atoms are very unstable and they want to settle down. They do this by spitting out radiation. And if the dose of radioactive material is large enough, then the radiation emitted can be damaging to human tissue or even lethal.
Investigators now know what caused the explosion, but they are horrified by the prospect of a much bigger crisis. Radioactivity doesn't just spread through the air. Scientists are terrified that the reactor core will melt into the water table underneath.
Once radioactive material hits the water table, then it can spread very, very quickly into maybe thousands and thousands of homes and drinking water and so on.
Residents of Kiev, only 65 miles away, have no idea that their lives are at risk. But for the men charged with controlling the disaster, it's a very real concern. They need to know if the core has melted. Benyamin Priyanishnikov gets the job. He has to crawl through a tunnel barely 30 inches wide to inspect the damaged core.
Why have I agreed to carry out this work? What do you mean I've agreed? I didn't agree. In those times, no one asked for consent.
Benyamin knows very well that he's risking his life. He steps into a room underneath the core, and suddenly something drops onto his head.
If radioactive fuel had fallen on my head, I would have died. I would have been a dead man.
Colleagues throw him a Geiger counter. The radiation levels are safe, so it isn't nuclear fuel that's landed on his head. It's uncontaminated rubble.
When I realized I was going to live, I felt so happy and delighted. It's difficult to believe. I would have stood no chance if it was fuel. My bones, they would have rotted.
Benjamin confirms that so far, the reactor core hasn't melted through, but authorities fear that it could. They decide to place a massive concrete slab underneath the reactor. But before they can make the slab, they need to build an access tunnel. It's a mammoth task. 400 miners dig around the clock. In just 15 days, they manage to complete a 550-foot-long tunnel. The concrete slab is maneuvered into position. Still, 200 tons of radioactive lava remains above the slab inside the reactor's wreckage. The radiation it releases could cause serious harm for many years. So authorities decide to stop this by building an enormous concrete tomb around the entire reactor. But nothing can be done because radioactive debris from the explosion continues to emit lethal doses of radiation into the air. The debris must first be cleared away. It's a job for the army. Thousands of so-called liquidators are drafted in from across the Soviet Union. They are put under the command of General Tarakanov.
I was summoned to the Politburo Commission and was told, "So Nikolai, we have decided that you are the most talented and courageous general, and you are to head the operation for the removal of nuclear fuel by soldiers." I said, "Are you out of your mind? Is a soldier a robot?"
The soldiers are ordered to shovel the radioactive debris back into the destroyed core.
You will find some blocks weighing 40 to 50 kilograms each. Carry those blocks to the pit and throw them in. They are doing it correctly, do you see?
The soldiers carry out their duties, wearing special lead clothing that weighs more than 65 pounds. Each man is only allowed to work for 3 minutes. But it's long enough to receive a lifetime dose of radiation. Thousands will die as a consequence in years to come.
I was being exposed to radiation, and I was sending soldiers to receive radiation. It was incredible.
Construction of the shelter continues throughout the cleanup operation. In a fight against time, it's completed in 206 days. But 200 tons of lethal uranium and a ton of even deadlier plutonium is still inside the shelter. And no one really knows if the shelter is enough to stop the radiation from escaping out of the core. Disaster. For the first time since the nuclear explosion in 1986, pump operator Boris Stolarchuk is back in a control room at Chernobyl.
I'm looking around and thinking, I used to run all this.
The investigation is finally able to answer the question, design flaw with the reactor or operator error? The critical chain of events springs from the actions of night shift workers who were ordered by supervisors to carry out a safety test. Leonid removes too many control rods from the reactor. Then Boris reduces the amount of cooling water flowing through it. Their actions make the reactor very unstable, but they don't realize it. And when they finally try to rectify these errors, it's too late. The fuse that leads to the massive blast has been lit. But investigators decide that the night shift wasn't to blame. Boris and Leonid were forced to carry out the safety test. The disaster was caused by systemic poor management. Three senior engineers were given 10-year prison sentences. Even though they were exonerated, Boris still feels the need to defend the actions of the night shift.
Unfortunately, there is still an opinion that the operational staff were to blame for the accident. As for me, I don't feel responsible, and I don't think the operators were to blame.
Today, the little town of Pripyat, once home to thousands of Chernobyl's workers, is so toxic it's sealed off from the public. Access is restricted in a 19-mile no-man's land around the nuclear plant. Any hope that residents may have had of returning to reclaim their homes is long gone. Oksana Savchenko was 13 years old at the time of the accident. She is permitted to return for a brief visit.
I feel pain, sorrow. When I first came here, I cried. It was very hard for me. Too many memories.
Her father, who was at the plant on the night of the explosion, was exposed to lethal amounts of radiation. He died in a Moscow hospital a few months later. Amazingly, the Chernobyl power plant stayed in operation for nearly 15 years. Workers commuted daily into the restricted area in spite of the fact that it was too dangerous to live there. Finally, in December of 2000, Chernobyl shut down for good. The Ukrainian government estimates that at least 8,000 people have died as a result of the catastrophe. But the United Nations believes it's still too early to establish the true picture. One thing, however, is certain. In the worst affected areas, the rate of thyroid cancer in children and teenagers has risen over 100 times. The disaster forced the Soviet Union to modify all reactors of a similar design to ensure the horror could never be repeated. Today, 200 tons of uranium and nearly a ton of deadly plutonium remain inside the destroyed reactor. In 1997, a group of 28 nations agreed to fund a 10-year plan for a long-term solution to Chernobyl. A 20,000-ton steel arch will completely enclose Chernobyl's reactor number 4. It will cost a massive $768 million. Key to the new project is the 4 giant cranes in the ceiling of the new shell. They're capable of breaking down the wreckage and removing radioactive dust. When complete, the hope is that the radioactive threat of Chernobyl can finally be defeated.